So I'm not able to really use the keyboard, so most of my input focus is using mouse and on-screen keyboard, but also dictation. With certain programs, it's hard to use dictation, and then using the mouse for a keyboard can be rather cumbersome.
One of the biggest limitations that I face is I am very, very heavily reliant on voice, and it works pretty well for most things, but I really run into significant barriers where I need to be able to use my voice for other things, like more human interaction with people around me.
Hey friends, we're back and we're having fun at Microsoft Build. We're gonna chat with some really interesting folks about some really interesting tech today. We're chatting with Brynnan Fink, who's a Principal Program Manager on Windows Silicon and Systems.
Well, Windows Silicon and System Integration, WSSI.
System Integration, fantastic. And Alex Dunn, CEO and founder of Cephable.
Hey.
How's it going?
Doing great, yeah, excited to be here.
So that is a beautiful blue laptop right there.
It's gorgeous.
That is
lovely. My favorite color, so excited.
Okay, so this has got all the latest tech in it, specifically those Snapdragon processors that we were hearing about before. It's got not just a CPU, GPU, but also an NPU, and I see that you've got the task manager open right there. Why does that matter? Because we are doing so much around accessibility right now. We are trying to make sure that everybody who wants to use a computer can use it in a way that is really authentic and complete to them. And I remember working with you a couple of years ago, you had done a whole bunch of prototypes and work on physical separate computers. So basically like a Raspberry Pi or a separate machine that you would plug into another machine.
Yep.
And it would allow people to interact with their computers in an accessible way, in a way that matched them. I don't see any additional hardware here, and that's one of the things that we're going to talk about today, isn't
it? That's right. All software running offline, on the machine. No new dongles, no cables, just take your laptop and use it in ways that work best for you.
Okay, so that's a really interesting idea, though. Separately, when you had a physical machine, the work was being done there. What is the kind of work I would want to do? If I'm differently abled, like for a while I had shoulder surgery and my arms were like this, and I was using speech to text.
Yeah.
So, you know, for a very long time, I couldn't move my shoulders above here, so I wasn't typing. I did everything on dictation. And it was easy because Windows had that built in. I could hit Windows H. But if I had different mobility challenges, what are ways that I might want to interact with my computer?
Yeah, so voice is a big one. One of the other things that we do with Cephable is camera-based inputs. So face expressions, head movements, you can sort of like tilt, turn, lean, raise your eyebrows, smile, open your mouth in different ways. All of those things can then be turned into controls to execute tasks on whatever apps you're using or across your entire sort of Windows system.
Okay. That sounds very processor intensive. Brynnan, I don't see how if I've got Teams and I've got Edge and I've got maybe a video game running that I'm gonna have enough power on a laptop to be able to do all of that kind of work.
Yeah, that's a fantastic point, and I think that's why we're so excited to be here with Cephable today, demonstrating one of many use cases for why an NPU can be so powerful. So in a traditional PC of several years ago, you've got a CPU and a GPU, and those are the core processors that you are leveraging for your day-to-day workloads. With the addition of the neural processing unit, the NPU, it's super efficient for AI workloads. So it does a lot of fantastic parallel computing, takes that off of your GPU, and frees it up for your day-to-day task flow. So rather than having Cephable software sitting on your CPU and your GPU, enabling the user to do their daily tasks while in parallel doing any kind of graphical intensive workloads, this allows the Cephable pipeline to move over to NPU, and the GPU is just sitting there waiting to do whatever task you're there to perform.
I think it's going to take a while for people to like get this and grok it, because it's been a while since the idea of a coprocessor has been introduced. You know, 30 years ago, there were 286s and 386s, and then they added a coprocessor for floating point. When video games like Quake came out, we added GPUs. But it's been 20 years since we've added another processor. And I've heard people online say, oh, the NPU is really small, it can't do anything, it has no power. They're not understanding that this has, like, oomph.
Absolutely.
Is this a little tiny chip that doesn't do anything, or is it got some chutzpah?
So the neural processing unit, it's not a brand new technology. We're celebrating it here today, but it is something that's been in the ecosystem for a little bit. We are introducing the Copilot Plus PC platform that has industry-leading neural processing capability with the Surface laptop and the new Surface Pro. That's coming in at 45 trillion operations per second, so that's 45 TOPS. And within this class of PCs, a number of workloads and the type of workloads that you're able to portion off to the NPU, freeing up in your CPU and your GPU, is really incredible. And I think that's why I'm so excited to be here today with Alex demoing one example of that here on our new Surface laptop.
So you said trillion.
Trillion.
Okay. And it's not a CPU per se. It's not a GPU. It is a thing that does machine learning, does AI things well.
Absolutely.
Okay, and that's what you needed it to do.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so what did you need it to calculate?
So we do our entire camera pipeline and machine learning models on the NPU now. So we do things from taking your camera feed to finding your face and then finding specific points of your face, tracking changes over time to that, and then being able to estimate basically the movements you're making to turn those into control. So we're running a high definition 1080p input feed to a model that's running entirely offline, tracking your face at usually 30 FPS or higher.
Wow, okay, so as a programmer who I'm now hearing that, I'm naively imagining how I'm gonna, you know, grab 60 frames a second, and I'm thinking about the algorithm that I'm gonna do on the CPU, and then I might learn about GPUs. I'm assuming if all that work is happening on the NPU, I'm not gonna see a lot of work happening on CPU and GPU.
Exactly, yeah. We have some numbers we can share in a little bit that show like we've got basically super low, almost zero GPU touch when in our like typical use case. And our CPU stays below like 15% on like what we call an average workload. So using apps like Visual Studio Code, using PowerPoint, having a whole bunch of edge tabs open, things like that, CPU stays super low. And then the NPU, you see the spikes and the waves of the models actually running and doing that inference.
Let's see it.
Yeah, let's do a demo. So for those who know me, they know that I love live demos, and especially the riskiest of live demos. So we're going to do some cool stuff with camera controls right here using the webcam built into this Copilot Plus PC. I'm also using a separate microphone here that I'm going to use for voice in order to dictate into GitHub Copilot. So we're going to actually write some code. But if you've never seen Cephable, just sort of quick view, you can create different controls for different apps you can use. You can ask our AI to generate them for you. You can change your settings. So when we look at things like camera controls and gestures, we can do things like change how sensitive it is. If I can't tilt my head super far one way or the other, I can increase the sensitivity. If I want to do a more intentional movement, I can decrease the sensitivity for like every type of movement. And then we can go ahead and just click start camera, which you see running right here. So it's not processing anything. But what I'm going to do is show you the controls that I have for Visual Studio Code with Copilot. So I've got head controls for navigating my code, but I've also got controls that allow me to raise my eyebrows to open up Copilot. So taking away that very tedious, like constant voice interaction that might be awkward for some folks. And then also I have start smiling, so I can do a really big grin in order to actually accept the changes. And then everything else is just voice and face movement, sort of using arrow keys, things like that. So let me open VS Code. I've got an empty C# file here. And I'm going to go ahead and resume my face lines and my face tracking here in Cephable. You can see the sort of real-time tracking going on. And then I'm going to raise my eyebrows, dictate in, and try to create something. Create an ASP.NET controller that uses Entity Framework for CRUD operations on an item called to-do. Oh, we're resetting it. Let's try it again. So I've accepted my changes. I can do things now like navigate up by just tilting my head. I'm not touching the arrow keys or anything. I can turn to shuffle through my code. I can then re-trigger things like GitHub Copilot if I go down and say, use task ID instead of ID in this query. Oh, let's try that again.
It's really loud in here.
Use task, here we go. Use task, oh, come on, GitHub, help me. That's classic. Well, I can continue to basically navigate my code with head controls, with other types of inputs, with my voice. But you'll see, I'll pause controls here. Over here in my task manager, that NPU is climbing. Our CPU sits under 12% usage. Our GPU is touching nothing, maybe a little bit because like camera processes before it even gets to Cephable might be using some of it. But now that I've paused my camera controls, you can also see that NPU levels off. We're not using it right now because I'm not running the inference against my face anymore. Looking at what we do in, oh, let me pull this up, sort of a simple graph of how we qualify these types of performance increases to the actual user and the value they get. looking at, well, what's left for the CPU and GPU utilization, comparing things to like using a dedicated graphics card from like a 3070 Ti consumer grade GPU all the way to an M3 MacBook Pro. What's left, right? So we're looking at under 15% on the CPU, again, that sort of blip in the GPU when running on the Qualcomm MPU. And then comparing that to when we're running Cephable controls on a graphics card, we're using more CPU, more GPU. On a MacBook Pro, we're really using the GPU pretty heavily to do the same things. But that means that when these are lower, users don't have to compromise on other performance of their applications. I don't have to go into my game graphics and turn them down in order to use these types of inputs. I don't have to go and close certain applications because my computer is really pushing it. And that's a common challenge that folks with disabilities face when using assistive tech like Cephable and many others. If I want to use voice input on Windows, it's using other parts of resources that otherwise I would want to use for my other applications.
I'm imagining if someone were playing a video game and it was really, really important and they want to make it so they jump when they raise their eyebrows, the last thing you want is a stutter or a moment where you miss a jump because you needed to yank GPU, CPU power away.
Right, and it's also where like the increased frames per second we get matters too, like especially for gaming. My interactions matter. If I want to turn and I'm racing a car, I want it to turn the car when I turn my head perfectly. I don't want to turn my head, wait a second, and then turn the car. So running at that 30 FPS or higher gives us that real-time interaction when we're playing games or doing other types of like fast-paced interactions with new types of controls.
And it's totally clear and obvious that it is local. It's worth pointing out, though, that that's why you want that to happen local.
Exactly.
This is the edge. The edge is your own machine.
Exactly. You don't want to stream your video and audio to the internet and hope that the right security measures are in place. It is offline. It's running on your PC. It's yours. You can personalize and bring to your applications.
Now, Brynnan, we talk a lot about power. We're talking about the tops. You said 45 trillion, which is a crazy number. But power, in this sense, means like getting work done. And when we talk about power, we also think about wattage and consumption. And NPUs think about power differently than GPUs, don't they?
Exactly. Because the NPU is most efficient at AI workloads running matrix operations locally, it allows you to sip power in a place where leveraging that on the CPU would really pull in as much juice as it can. And even on the GPU is much more adept than the CPU is, but the NPU takes that even a step further. I think I really do want to highlight again what y'all were just talking about in terms of why you would want a local NPU. So we do a lot of AI workloads in the cloud. That's something that's really important for the AI industry, and we are seeing that light up across the ecosystem. But having an NPU where you're able to run your AI workloads locally allows you to benefit from a variety of areas. Latency is a big one. Making that round trip to the cloud when milliseconds matter is huge. Privacy is another huge one. We're in an area and an age when data privacy is at an all-time level of importance, and being able to run your workloads that are treating your sensitive data locally where they never leave your machine is an incredible benefit over the cloud.
That's actually a great point. So all of this work that you were doing right here, if you weren't using Copilot, which talks to the cloud, you could have done that on an airplane if you needed to.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Cephable is not phoning home or talking to anyone about any of this stuff.
The only thing that we use the internet for with Cephable is like syncing your settings. Like if you're using the Cephable mobile app and you wanted to like change your sensitivity from there and have it show up real time on your PC, then you need to be connected to the internet. Or if you wanted to like make changes to a set of controls from one device to another, then you would, but otherwise everything's offline. It's right there just running on your PC.
Where do people learn about this? Like, do they download it? Do they get it in the store? Where does this person get involved?
You can download it from our website at cephable.com. It's free for individuals for any personal non-commercial use cases. So go ahead and try it out across your different devices. You can generate as many controls for different apps you want. And then developers can also explore how we're able to integrate these controls natively into their applications to help them empower their users to bring their personalized level of accessibility to the apps that they're building.
So if I've got a person in my life who is disabled or differently abled, I can go and use Cephable now. I can set it up for them, maybe over a weekend, and then spend time tweaking, customizing it to them.
Exactly.
If I don't have an NPU on one of these new machines, what will be doing the work?
It's going to run on either the CPU or GPU, depending on what you have, right? If you have a GPU, we're going to try to accelerate there. If not, we'll run on the CPU. But that's where you might run into situations where you may have to compromise on things like changing your graphics in your games, right? Lowering the graphics quality or not running a whole bunch of really complex workloads. Or if you do, just expect that you're not going to get, the 30 plus frames per second. That might be fine for certain use cases, though.
Okay. And then, Brynnan, if I want to learn as a developer how to do the kind of stuff that Alex and his team did, where am I going to go on Microsoft Learn to figure that out?
Absolutely. So we have been spending a ton of time here at Build talking through all of the various ways that Microsoft is showing up to make that as easy as possible. We do have a few aka.ms links that we have built out, and we'll get onto the screen, the first of which, aka.ms/NPU, will help to tie together all of the capabilities and the support resources that we have available. Second one, aka.ms/win-ai.
Very cool. And then if you want to learn all about Cephable, it's C-E-P-H, able.
Yep, it's perfect.
Very nice, C-E-P-H, able. This is really freaking cool. This makes me want to use it, because whether you are differently abled or whether you are fully abled, this can be useful for everyone.
100%. It's new types of inputs. Even for folks that might have like RSIs, repeated strain injuries, like carpal tunnel syndrome, or risk of it.
I've had two surgeries.
Try a new control. Try using voice for a little bit instead. Try adding a face expression or a head movement. Give yourself a break, or just try creating some new experiences. You can do a lot of fun stuff with it.
Fantastic. We're learning all about some great, exciting things happening in the space of NPUs and AI here at Microsoft Build.